organization. So these are our core things that we work. And there are other two community-led organizations, which is NSDF and Mahila Milan, which are the core ground organizations which SPARC works with. So SPARC is more of the legal, the financial, and a bit of technical support, the formal face that it supports these two organizations. So picking up from what she was talking about, Shelter Associates, we have a bit different module in which we work. So talking about sanitation, when we talk about providing individual toilets, so it's a very ideal situation that we all want to reach, but in Bombay we do not have that sort of densities. With very, very high densities in slums, it's not possible to provide individual toilets. So the whole thing is led by the community because of NSDF and Mahila Milan, where the slum dwellers themselves are the source of figuring out the issues. They themselves do the enumerations, which is about collecting the data, putting it together and trying to identify what the issues is and what are their priorities about what they want. And collectively together, they do the mapping as well. So the maps that we were talking about is drawn by the community. They spot out their huts and they tell where there is space and where collectively they can build toilets. And the whole system works like this, that the community toilet is being constructed by the women. So there is a SPARC Nirman construction company, which is again a non-for-profit company, which was initiated because the women could themselves construct these toilets and they could supervise and how it is, they've learned how it is built and they built it. And there is a pass of about 20 rupees per household that they pay and all of them use these toilets together. So, and there where it comes is that women do not have problems in using these toilets. And the operation and maintenance is also taken care of by this money. So it's like a rotating fund sort of thing that you don't have to do anything for the maintenance. And the community, because it's been involved right from the beginning till the end, has a sense of ownership as much as it is for any individual toilet we might have in our houses. So that is what it does in the crack, what you've been saying. So are there any questions in the same lines? Yeah. Because there are a lot of other things that we do, but because of the time thing, I'm just...
Yeah. How do you get them motivated in the first place?
How do we get them motivated? Okay, so because there's what we call as trust building, it's like we as professionals, when we go talk to people, they don't trust us. And there is this network of NSDF, the National Slum Dwellers Federation, which has been working on ground for the last 35-40 years. And it's that they have leaders among themselves who represent the community and they bring out issues and they mobilize. So it is everything that is started from them. They know what they want. We don't tell them what they need. Because certain times, for example, there's a Swachh Bharat Abhiyan, we all know about it. It's giving you 5,000 rupees to build a toilet. It's a question that I put to you. Do you think that 5,000 rupees can build you a toilet? It just gives us a pan, probably. It doesn't, and nobody talks about a system. What about sanitation is a system. I think we all agree about it. It is not about just a pan and a roof on top. It's about what do you do to bring in the whole system about decentralized sanitation systems. So that is what we've been working for. Because we know that how good and how efficient our sewerage systems are. It doesn't reach to most of the neighborhoods that we've lived in. So providing these systems or extending them by the government to the slums is far, far beyond imagination. Mindsets, and this is where we need to begin, because it's not about a project, it is about the change of mindset. So it's not that there is a project for which you need to go collect data. It is that you already need to have that data in hand, for which when you have a project, you know when to react. So one of the core activities that the Federation does is that they collect data not because it needs to be fed into a project. It is because that they need to identify that they also are a part of the city, they also have a right to the city, and that they exist there. That is very important. And that is the core reasons why we do enumerations or we do this sort of surveys, which is already there with us. So we have this whole mammoth task of doing data collection, which is just there, and it's used as and when, you know, there are projects or as and when there are issues. And that's how the whole, yeah.
So, I mean, let us say,
I'm coming more from an education standpoint, but tell me if this works. So let's say you have somebody from the NSDF who goes into a slum to talk to, you know, a resident. When the connection bit of it is happening, it's easier because, you know, they can relate to something.
Yes.
But if the NSDF person says something and asks them to do it, which goes into a little bit of preachy land, do they do it? Because they're equals at the moment.
Yes.
Do they want to listen to somebody then?
Yes, it does work that way. So I would like to quote Sheila, that she says that poor trust poor, and that's how it works. When we go, it doesn't do that way. So if that is what you're saying, that when a leader or say a community themselves try to go and preach other communities that let's do this for a common cause, like now they are also trying to look at scholarships that can be given to children to motivate them to get education and learn. It does work. Yes, it works.
The data that you've collected,
yes,
is available. You're saying that you're not collecting for
it. Yes, it is not.
So
the idea is, the idea is not to collect data for something. It's to collect because the citizens, they need to know that they have issues and collectively they can make an effort to do.
Is this available for anyone to see, data which we could use for different projects?
Yes, it is available with Spark. Yeah, it's available with Spark.
So the question is, it open source?
Yes,
it's not available.
No, it's not open source. No, it's not open source. That is because it's sensitive also in a way, because, you know, we talk about vote banks, the representatives, they can use it, you know, for various reasons. So it's not open source, but yes, we are open to share.
Okay.
Yeah.
One linked question to what she was asking. So you're collecting data which is at a large scale, right?
Yes.
How do you fund that data?
About 70 cities.
How do you fund that?
So
like she was asking one question, right? Like how do you fund this technology of collection, maintaining the data?
Okay. So the data is collected by the community, okay? So they themselves put their time into collecting it. So there is no funds required for that. But to maintain it, to have it, we have, you know, we have this collective offices where we are working with the Federation, we feed the data. And it's through funds. We have funders who...
How does that process work? Like how the community comes forward to collect the data? Like what is the inspiration or what is the drive for them to collect?
It's because they want to know that they exist there and they want to identify their issues as a community. Because you and me say that you have something, you know, or I have an issue, there's nobody who's going to address it. But collectively, if 100 of us say that, look, all of us have say 5 issues, but the priority is to go for sanitation. Or sometimes they have toilets, but their priority probably is, you know, to go for street lights. So then those kind of things are missed out when it is at an individual level. So that's how it works.
Anything that motivation exists? Like
yes, that motivation has been demonstrated through a lot of projects that Spark has been doing in sanitation, housing, and in other sectors also.
So I have a little question, like Spark is, you know, around for 30 years now. And it's taken a long time to build this trust and to build this community, whether it's Mahila Milan,
NSDF,
and that's not possible for everyone to do, you know, to have that 30-year-old history. So have you had any, can you share an example where, say, a relatively new community that you're working with has been able to do this in a shorter period of time? Because
So one of the projects that is being demonstrated widely is the MUTP project, which is the Mumbai Metro Rail, the Mumbai Rail Transportation Project, which is about, to put it in brief, it's that we know that the rail systems in Mumbai, it's linear, and there were a lot of slums across this who've been staying for like about 2 decades, and the rail corridor needed expansion, and they were staying like about say 1 meter from the railway line. And they needed to be cleared. And all this while the government had ideas of eviction. But when they realized that the numbers were too big, they were like about 19,000 households, families. So when they realized that, so they came to Spark asking whether we can do it. And now those people living across the railway lines were not a part of the NSDF. They were new, like say sort of 10 years is quite new. And they then, in order to remove them or sort of relocate them into another location, it needed a whole long process. So there, the NSDF, you know, the Federation had been house to house. They had done focus group discussions, trying to tell them about the works that they've done earlier and what could be done in order to, you know, be able to relocate them. And they used to do this numbering of households during this enumeration process. And then through trust and through already done demonstrations, it was easy to develop trust. So that is how it has worked. You know, in say settlements where there has been no networking there before. And then the whole of the railway line is now clear, and now they have been able to commute 10 times more passengers, how they've not been able to do before.
Thank you.
So that's